Entanglement is very important for quantum cryptography. So how can we find out whether a state is entangled? Suppose we have some state, psi AB, of some qubit A and some qubit B. What we want to do is we want to devise a test to figure out whether such states are entangled. So how could we do this? To the rescue comes John Bell, who devised something called a Bell test. John Bell actually devised a Bell test not with the idea of testing entanglement itself, but with the idea of figuring out whether nature is classical or maybe quantum. We have done such a Bell test, in fact, the first loophole-free Bell test, here in Delft. And you will see a special lecture about it later. How does such a Bell test look like? And how can we use it to test for entanglement? The modern perspective on a Bell test is in the form of a game. And let's for the moment forget about these quantum states and measurements, and let's just think about playing a simple game with our favorite parties, Alice and Bob. In this game, we will ask Alice and Bob questions, and we will call these questions X and Y. Here in this lecture, X and Y are just going to be single bits. We will choose these questions with some probability. We will play this game many times, and in every round, we choose X and Y with probability half each. Alice and Bob are going to give us some answers, and we will call these answers A for Alice and B for Bob. These answers will also be just single bits here. Any game has some rules. Here the rule is going to be that Alice and Bob win if and only if X times Y is equal to the sum of the answers A and B mod 2. Alice and Bob really try to win the game, and we allow them to agree on any strategy they want beforehand. But during the game, they're forbidden to communicate. Indeed, you can see that if Alice and Bob could communicate during the game, they would always be able to win the game. Alice could just take her input X, send it over to Bob. She would always output A being 0, and now Bob, who knows X, A and Y, can always compute the right answer B. This is why, to make this game interesting, we're going to forbid communication during the game. The quantity that we will be interested in is the probability that Alice and Bob win the game. This probability is the average over the questions X and Y, where the quarter comes from the fact that we choose X and Y, each with probability half. And we're interested in the probability that, given some question X and Y, Alice and Bob produce some answers, A and B. And we're interested in, if I fix an answer of A, the correct answer for Bob would be given by this rule. So the probability that they win can be expressed by applying this rule. It turns out that if Alice and Bob are classical, meaning that they follow a classical strategy, which you can think of as just a lookup table that tells Alice and Bob which answers to give for which questions, then the maximum probability that they can achieve is 3/4. And it's actually easy to see where these 3/4 come from. Note that the winning condition basically says that if one of the questions is 0, then Alice and Bob should be giving the same answer. Only if both X and Y are 1 should they give opposite answers. In 3 out of the 4 cases, either x or y is 0, and in this case, giving the same answer is a good thing. So Alice and Bob can just agree to give always the same answer. This means that they're correct in 3 out of the 4 cases, leading to the 3 quarters. If you want, you can look at all possible strategies that Alice and Bob could follow to convince yourself that this is really the maximum. The genius of John Bell was actually to realize that in such simple games, quantum can achieve a higher winning probability. So using a quantum strategy, Alice and Bob can do better, even though they cannot communicate during the game. So what is this quantum strategy? Alice and Bob can pick whatever state rho AB they want to share before they start the game. They can also decide on what measurements to make. You should be thinking here that Alice has 2 measurements. She will make one if the question x is 0, and she will make the other if x equals 1. And the answer that she's going to give is nothing else but her measurement outcome. Similarly, Bob can decide on 2 measurements. One for y being 0 and the other for y being 1. And his answer, B, is just the measurement outcome. Let me now give you a strategy that can do better than the 3 quarters. Alice and Bob share a state, rho AB. And the state they're going to share is the EPR pair that you've seen before. The measurements that they're going to make are the following. Alice is going to measure in a basis. And if she's going to measure x equals 0, so she gets question 0, the basis that she'll measure in is the standard basis. And for convenience, I'll actually this time draw the vector 0 in this direction, and 1 in this direction. The orthogonal doesn't really matter. So this here is vector is associated with x being 0 and answer being 0, and again x being 0 and answer being 1. If Alice gets asked question x equals 1, she will measure in the Hadamard basis. So this here is plus, corresponding to answer 0 if Alice is asked question 1. And minus. And it will be convenient for me to draw minus down here. So I'll write it as 1 minus 0. Okay, so it differs from our normal minus, just with the extra minus in front, being 1. Let me give this vector a name. I'll call it 1 for outcome 1. I'll put the 1 to remind ourselves that this was question 1. So all of this is on Alice. So Bob is also going to perform a measurement in a basis. And the basis that Bob is going to measure in is this one. So this will be his basis. If y is 0 and this vector is associated with his outcome, 0. And this vector will associate it with y equals 0 and outcome 1. And I'll give it a name, call it 1 for Bob, for question 0. If Bob gets asked the question y equals 1, he will also measure in a basis, namely this one. B. For question 1. And orthogonal to this is this vector. 1b for question 1. If we want to know now how we can compute the probabilities of certain measurement outcomes, what we have to compute, so the probability that they will get outcomes A and B, given questions X and Y, is given by psi. Here I have the measurement operator for Alice, which is A for Alice. For question X, tensor B for question Y, for Bob, on the maximally entangled state. I'm not going to perform this calculation here, but in the lecture notes you can find all these probabilities for their strategy. If you compute the winning probability, you will find that this winning probability is larger than 3/4. In fact, it will be roughly 0.85. We then see that there exists a strategy for Alice and Bob using maximally entangled state that gives them a winning probability of 85%. This is larger than 3/4. This is very beautiful, of course, both for understanding the foundations of quantum mechanics and also for applications. From a foundational perspective, we can verify that nature is not classical by performing this Bell test many times, which has also been done in Delft, and we can see that we are significantly above the 3/4, meaning that indeed nature is not classical. The cool thing for quantum cryptography is that also the opposite is true. If we observe a winning probability that is strictly larger than 3/4, then we know that in quantum mechanics the state must have been entangled. In fact, if they can observe a winning probability of 85%, then the state that Alice and Bob share must have been maximally entangled. So there's a quantitative relationship between the winning probability and the amount of entanglement. You will see much more about this when we later discuss device-independent cryptography.